Welcome to episode 11 of the Willpower podcast. My guest today is John Haboush. John is a leader in the sales industry and the host of the podcast, the Beyond Pipeline podcast. John is an inspiration to me. I met him a few months back at the Austin Boardwalks here in Austin, and he has given me many words of wisdom, especially throughout this episode. Hope you enjoy. Get into it.
Let's do it.
What is the Beyond Pipeline podcast?
The Beyond Pipeline podcast was created because sales rep, sales folks, SDRs, BDRs, AEs, specifically in software sales, but also could be in AE sales. A lot of our discussions are around how do we drive more pipeline? How do we close more business, make more money? And I felt that even just growing up, I had people in my family, they're all alive, so I'm gonna keep it pretty anonymous, but suffer from depression and anxiety, things like that. And I saw other people in our industry start to do that. And so I created it just because we needed a space to have high performing reps share how they keep their, you know, how they deal with stress, how they deal with anxiety. So I created that space through the podcast. Mm-hmm. And that's why I created it.
Okay. So is this more of a, do you see it as a way to make people more efficient, like a roundabout way?
I see it as a way, like the core problem I'm working to solve is I truly believe most people are not engaged or don't feel engaged and empowered in their own work. And it's mainly because they don't understand what their values are and what really matters to them. And so they're showing up and they're like, I hate this job. It's really hard. I thought I'd make more money more quickly, and people are just stressed the fuck out. And so I'm solving that problem by saying, hey, let me go interview top performers in our space and let me go talk about how share and discuss with them how they deal with those things about feeling misaligned or feeling stressed out. And so my goal is for people to be like, hey, I learned from that person how to deal with anxiety the next time I think about my quota, or hey, I really like the person's story, it inspired me. I learned how I'm going to, you know what, sales is probably not for me. I should go do something else, start my own business, right? Like that's the end goal. So do they become more efficient? I think become more efficient could be a byproduct of it, but it's really about like living an aligned life with your values, which makes you, in my opinion, much more effective. That's why I created it.
What do you think draws people to sales initially?
It depends who you are, right? I think a lot of people are drawn to sales because they're like, oh, I'll make a lot of money quickly and all this stuff. And the reality is, especially now, you have to be extremely good at what you do to make a lot of money. And so the top reps right now are very good at what they do. And the ones that are just getting laid off or not doing so well are probably because they don't love the job and they're not willing to learn and evolve. And so that's why people will join, I think, initially, is to get a lot of money, make a lot of money. There's not a lot else that, you know, they feel like they can go do. And then I think there's a small percentage of population that candidly, like myself, that like, if there was no one on the planet, I'd still be writing like cold call scripts or something and be, you know, talking about mental stuff. And so I was just like, I love doing it. Like, so I think there's two different camps, probably many, but those are kind of the two different camps. Some people love it, small percentage of population, most people do it for the money.
Okay. And was there ever a transition for you? Did you ever, have you always been in this boat?
As far as just like loving sales? I've always been in the boat, but as I've gotten better and better, and I've gotten better through making mistakes and investing heavily in my own skill development and making more mistakes and like thinking and evolving. As I get better, it gets more exciting because the stakes get higher and you work on more exciting projects. Mm-hmm. And for example, an advisor and CMO of a large ticket seller that you'd probably know. I outbounded the account for 7 months. They finally came inbound. And we're working on how do we like reduce their overall customer acquisition costs and extend their lifetime value. And I'm talking to a guy that, you know, this gentleman at one point led lynda.com when they're getting acquired by LinkedIn. I mean, that's exciting stuff. Mm-hmm. I get to work on a project like that. You know, so that makes me even more invested. So I'm like, I can do this again. And the deals are bigger. Right. And so it's all exciting.
Right. Okay. So let's talk about mental performance.
Okay.
Is that encapsulated in the podcast?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's go into that. So what do you usually see in terms of people looking for help in that area or struggling in that area? And then how do you guide them?
Yeah. So I think I'll first define mental performance in my words. It's the ability to manage one's emotional state so that you can live the life that you want to live and ideally better serve those around you. Right. It's like my general definition. It's kind of off the cuff of what I would say. And so the things that people usually struggle with, at least the people I've spoken to and watch, is one, people are just disengaged at work, right? They're disengaged at work, not because their company sucks. It also might be true because they probably don't even think about like how does what I'm doing now make me a better person and help me build to become and become the person I want to become next 3 to 5 years and create the life I want. Not that I think about that. It's collecting a paycheck, moving through life, not caring. And so I think that's like the disengaged bucket. People are disengaged. Number two, people are just anxious, right? I think they all fall within the same. They all kind of overlap, but you know, people are getting anxious, especially in sales, because pressure to close quota. The job's gotten more challenging. And if you're mediocre, now you suck. And if you were good, now you're mediocre. And if you're great, now you're good. And then if you evolve, you can get back to great, whatever it is. But and so I think people are very anxious because they didn't like the job in the first place. And now they have to like really learn it and evolve. And they're like, I don't have the motor to go do that. I don't have the willpower to go do this. And, you know, I could get cut tomorrow. And so I think those are the biggest things that, and then obviously then the more, even more extreme than that is going to be the depression, things like that. I've experienced depression briefly a couple times in my life. It's clearly not something that my body goes into very often, very fortunately. But I think people also then get depressed because you start to lose hope. You go through that spectrum to disengage and anxious and depressed. It's just like all builds on itself. And then people lose hope and, you know, they got to find a better way.
Okay. So a lot of it is alignment, sounds like.
Alignment with one's values.
Right. Getting yourself behind what you're actually doing.
Yeah. One's values being defined as the emotional states you want to feel on a consistent basis. One would label them priorities. So you might say, I value my family, or I value my car, or I value making money. What you really value is the emotional state or the emotions you get behind that physical thing.
Yeah.
So if you value achievement, what you really value is maybe the feeling of excitement or the feeling of awe at what you've done. That's really what you value.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, to make it more simple for people, it's just, what are your priorities in life? Those are generally your values. And then it's like, what emotions do each of those values or priorities evoke for you? And those are really your values. But keep it simple. It's just the things that you prioritize in life.
Okay. So we talked briefly about meditation right before this. What is your meditation practice like?
It's evolved over the years. I used to do as a teen, I got into meditation by like 20 minutes a day, maybe. And then I...
What got you into it?
You know, it's one of those things, man, where I was just like, I know there's probably something bigger than me, and it feels good to connect that way. It was mainly actually a mental performance thing, where I was like, hey, I can focus better, I can better regulate my emotions, and I can lock in. That was mainly what it was at first. And then can't let it evolve, where I went through 3 years a year ago as I came out of it, but like I had 3 years where I was only living off of like 6 or 8 foods. I had health issues from stress and shit. And so I went deep into meditation for like an hour a day for probably 2 or 3 years, and totally changed my health. And it was a crazy experience. So that's kind of an atypical thing that happened. Mm-hmm. Went to a bunch of meditation retreats, And now I do it about 30 minutes every day.
And what do you think it does for you at this point?
It keeps me aligned with the energy that I would call God. And it helps me to release anything that maybe during the previous day that I wasn't willing to let go of from like an energetic standpoint. Mm-hmm. Obviously it helps me to focus. Like even if I close my eyes now, I can immediately feel it. My mind expands. I can just feel it just out. Mm-hmm. It's a very good place to be. So that's what it does for me.
Yeah. Like expands that space of like consciousness, whatever.
Yeah. But it helps you to realize that like, I'm not the only person sitting here. And there's something greater than this physical body. Like the problem people experience, in my opinion, when they feel all anxious or just not engaged in life, is they're too much in their head. Mm-hmm. And they're too much like listening to stuff going on in their head, and there's no space for them to go to. They're just like so in it. Whereas if you can just close your eyes and just feel it, there's just expansion of space through this wall. It just gives you like a, whoa, okay, like, that's right. I'm not this body. It helps you separate. Mm-hmm. Helps me separate. I'll speak for myself. Helps me to separate.
Yeah. Yeah, there's that like self, you get so wrapped up in your problems and
what is like shit
immediately in front of you that you can, forget.
Yeah.
Where do you find willpower?
One word answer is anger. So I'll expand upon that. I think this is a thing people will debate, and I think there's a very fine line. I think the reality is that at the end of the day, like you have to use whatever is available to you. And I was fortunate enough, I'm looking at this retroactively, like I had a childhood that gave me a lot of things to be generally angry about. I'm very grateful I was born in the United States, like wouldn't change a thing, but there were some things that happened that just weren't the easiest. And so that's what was available to me. I didn't consciously know at the time, but that's what drove me. And candidly, I still use it today. But it's much more now. I mean, now I'm like, okay, I see it. I got it. And that was part of the health issues that I experienced for a 3-year period. Turns out your body gets pretty fucked up. You run off that for a prolonged period. So I think like that was the initial catalyst. But then when I began to emotionally mature and really think about it, like the thing that drives me now is just knowing that like whatever I do today, even like me choosing to come here, things like that, every single decision I make is adding up to the person I'm going to become. And like, I use death a lot to remind myself that I'm not coming back. And you can believe what you want, and I totally respect it, whatever. But like, it's even if I am coming back, I'm going to pretend like I'm not, because it's easier that way. Because then it's like, all right, well, you better go and, you know, talk to that girl you think's cute at the pool, or you better go and like, you know, treat your friends with respect. And, you know, I could not see you again. This would be the last time we talk to each other. I get hit by a fucking car and I leave here. You know, like, and it sounds like brutal to people, but like, is anything else working for anyone else? You know, like it seems like the people who are winning the most in life and feel the most aligned are the people who have the most extreme views generally. Like,
yeah.
So it's just,
and like the reality of,
yeah,
of death is that no one really knows.
No one really knows. Yeah. So it's just like, I'm not here to debate with you. I'm just going to do what's useful. Yeah. I'm not coming back. Mm-hmm. And so like that, in addition to now, okay, who am I going to become for my family, my friends, my future wife, my future kids, that really drives me now. In the short term, though, like, I mean, I still feel it. When you ask me when I meditate, I still feel that anger. The anger sits right here. Like, I can absolutely feel it. And it's still there. And so you just, like, that's still, like, I still use it if I, you know, potentially need to. Mm-hmm. But I realize it's not a good long term. But, I mean, again, like, you use what you have, right? So it's kind of a two-part answer. But my more mature answer is, it's now who do I want to become for the people around me.
Yeah, no, I've used a mix of like fuel sources,
yeah,
definitely throughout time. I think the bigger one for me is like shame in myself.
Of interesting.
Like, if I don't do this thing, then I'm a piece of shit.
So it sounds like it's okay if you don't do X, then you're a piece of shit. Mm-hmm. Like, where does that come from for you?
It's probably, I mean, it's something deep in my past where like I felt inadequate for something. And so then it's like, if I don't work out today, if I don't eat right today, mm-hmm, like I am that person that I felt that I was. And so it's constantly just fighting to get back to baseline, if that makes sense. Because if I don't do it, I fall back.
Interesting. How is that affecting your ability to experience peace on a day-to-day basis?
That, so this is something I wouldn't say, it's not gone, but I've been working on moving away from it because, like, it works. It works as a fuel source. I don't think it's a healthy fuel source. It definitely doesn't help with peace. There was one night a few months ago where I didn't do some training that I had planned on doing. And I was laying in bed and I just felt bad. And I was like, fuck, I didn't do it. And then there was just a moment where I realized, like, I don't need to feel bad right now. This isn't helping me. There's, like, there's no benefit is coming from me feeling bad. I'm imposing this on myself.
Yeah.
And so I've been slowly having that realization that it is not necessary. It's not the only way. I think there are other ways of reinforcing behavior, and that's through, like, aligning with a genuine purpose rather than a fear of how am I going to treat myself if I don't do this.
No, that's totally fair. It's still useful.
It still works.
Still useful. People don't say that, but it's still useful.
Yeah. It is important to acknowledge that that works. That will get you results. It's just not necessarily going to be enjoyable along the way.
Totally.
Anger was your thing.
That was
what fueled a lot of it.
Yeah, it's not like I don't know if I consciously chose it or not. I think it's like some kind of heady philosophical, but like at the end of the day, it was definitely the emotion of choice. Mm-hmm. And in some instances, like, anger is probably pretty useful, candidly. If you're depressed, you don't really want to do anything. If you're anxious, you don't really want to do anything. If you're angry, you just want to fucking go do something.
Was it like a proving, where you feel like you're proving something?
I appreciate the question. It's pretty similar to what you said. There was actually, I had a big moment the other day where it was raining, I was sitting on my own. I said something from there's some people live right now that I won't speak, but like, I was like, oh, like, I felt like a piece of shit due to that moment, or at least I chose to make that meaning. I didn't, like, it wasn't the moment's fault, it was on me. But, mm-hmm. And so then I was like, okay, like, if that's the case, then I will do everything I can to achieve as much as possible. And that happened at age 11. I remember it now, like it was yesterday. I never realized it though, but I sat with myself long enough to be like, oh, okay. Like, I think people are anxious that, like, don't, like, you just gotta sit in the silence and just be with yourself and let the emotions come up and ask, like, what's causing this to be here? And just do that over and over again. The answers are there.
Yeah, sitting in silence. Dude, I think that was your topic at a walk one time.
I think it was. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's this walk here in Austin, and you bring a topic and it's a big group event. But yeah, yours was just like quiet time. I really liked that because that's something I try to prioritize. It's like, get some form of quiet time in my day. Like, because having constant simulation, like, you just can miss so much. And you don't give your brain that opportunity to, like, clear itself out almost.
Exactly.
Like, there have been times where I've given myself quiet time after, like, a full day of being busy doing stuff, and, like, so much shit is coming up in my brain.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, this is just my brain. Like, it just needs to filter out stuff.
Totally.
So that's a big one. Do you think there are things people get wrong about willpower and motivation?
There's a lot. I'd say one that, like, people seek motivation too often. I think it's the discipline that ends up really mattering the most. I think motivation is a great spark to change. Mm-hmm. It's just like, for example, like, going through this 3-year stint of just not being healthy, like, dude, I was eating 6 foods. I was getting allergic reactions to everything. I went to doctor after doctor, spent probably $15,000 on doctors. Out of pocket. I already had 40K student loans. Like, I was in the shit. And it's like, it hurt. Like, it just, and I wasn't eating, like, it was like fucking ground turkey and shit. And I think, like, the discipline to keep, I mean, my only option was literally to meditate, because that's all I, like, literally, it's all, there's no medicine. If people are not going to believe me listening to this, like, there was, like, no medicine they could give me. Like, if you have chronic issues with your immune system, like, there's no medicine that they have to just cure that. It's not like a broken arm, mm-hmm. right? It's a big untalked, now it's being more talked about. It's a big untalked about topic within medicine. I didn't find that. I found that out the hard way. And so it's just like the discipline to keep like showing up. And like, I literally meditated every single day for an hour for like 2.5 years, like through almost 3 years. I think it's like 600 and maybe it was like 700 and something hours. I mean, yeah, dude,
I'm just sitting.
Like, that's not motivation. That's like discipline. And so like, that's just like one. So I think the misconception is that when you feel motivated, it's going to last. And I know now that it's like, it's not. And so I know at some point discipline is going to come into play. And this is where then we can start talking about like priorities, and like you can be more disciplined when you're only focused on one or two major things, really one major thing. Example being, you know, do I want to focus on my sales career or this podcast? Or if I do both, like one's definitely going to be the main entree and one's going to be the side dish. And I can be more disciplined now because I'm putting all my focus in one thing. People are too scattered, mm-hmm. right? They want to do a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of that. And then when stuff gets hard, they stop. Right. And so that's the byproduct of like being motivated per se. People looking to be motivated relates like gotta be disciplined on like one thing and just focus on it.
Yeah.
So yeah, I can go on for days, but I think the biggest mistake people make is that they expect the motivation to last and they have no system or process to keep discipline over a prolonged period. And you know, we can talk about what that could look like. But yeah, that's the biggest mistake.
Yeah. Do you want to go into that?
Yeah. I could talk about like the system that I have to create more discipline in my life, if that's more helpful.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, so I think first of all, like let's define discipline. Discipline is the ability to consistently show up and do something, take an action when you do not want to for a prolonged period of time. So whereas motivation is in the moment, you feel emotionally, you know, let's call it, say, inspired to be able to want to go and like do X, Y, Z, and then it fades. Right. Emotions like sugar, discipline's like vegetables, right? So that's kind of how I would think of it.
Yeah, motivation is the desire to do something. Like you have that emotional.
You have that, you feel it in the moment, and then discipline's doing it even when you don't want to. That's a good way to put it. It's good. So I think like the number one thing I do is I ask, okay, like let's say I want to start a new habit. Let's say when I want to meditate every day, or I want to go run every day or work out every day or whatever it is, which those are things that I do. I've done them for longer than I can count. Then the question is, okay, actually that's not true. There are a couple of days this year I didn't work out. So it's like three. I'm just keeping it real. I'm keeping it real. That being said, then it's like, okay, first off, why do I want to do this? And it's, and like the six pack or the whatever, or like, you know, looking like you, whatever the reason is, that's great. But then it's like, no, like, why do I really want to do this emotionally? Like, people need to be emotionally charged and emotionally engaged in that thing that they want to be consistent with for a prolonged period. Like, that's what has the emotion attached. Okay, I want to work out more consistently because then I know I'll feel more confident, and then it's going to play into how I show up at work, how I go out and you know, talk to girls in my dating life, and it's going to how I show up for my friends. That's one of the main reasons why I work out. Or I'm going to go work out because I know that's going to make me a better person. I mean, help me become more disciplined because I'm not going to want to show up some days. And that's going to be a better son, and I'm going to be a better brother, and be a better friend, and be a better future husband, father. Like, those are the things I really think about if I don't want to work out. Like, oh, that's what I, so it starts there. Why do I want to do this? And like, really trigger your emotions of like, why do I really want, like, I feel that in my body. When I say I want a six pack, it doesn't like really emotionally charge me. It sounds good, but like, whatever. And then two, it's like, okay, what is the system that's going to make me consistently do this? I have a gym membership at Squatch. I know when I go to Squatch, I'm going to meet some cool people. There's also going to be attractive women there, which as a dude, it's just like, it helps because I'm like, okay, like there'll be someone cool to go talk to. Like, it just is what it is. Like, it's just, I use that to my advantage. It's just, it's hardwired in your body. You might as well just use that. So, okay, cool. I know there's going to be some attractive women there that are nice and I can just hang out with, talk to. And then like, I know I'm going to have a steam at the end. And like, so I create an environment where I will want to go to. To go and do that. So that's another thing. It's like, what is the environment that I can create there where it incentivizes me to go do this? And then three is, it's like, okay, I keep a habit tracker every single week. So then I go, okay, I track the habits every week. Did I work out every day this week? Yes or no? Did I meditate? And I actually track it, so I'm accountable. So it's really a basic three-part framework. It's what is it I want to do and why? Really clear, emotional triggered. Two is, make your environment such that you can incentivize you to do that action without you having to put in any effort. It's just like, okay, I'm going to go to the gym. I know I'm going to have my gym stuff ready and I'm going to go. And then after that, make sure you track it every single week of, did I hold myself accountable, yes or no? Very, very simple. Like, that's literally it.
Okay. What do you use for tracking?
Piece of paper I made that just is like a bunch of, now it's just a notebook, but I write down the, I think I have 7 or 8 core habits every single week that I really keep track of. I just literally track it and I go, how well did I do this week? What's up?
Did you? Yeah.
It's that simple. You can just take a notebook and just call it your weekly measurement notebook. And as you're planning, I plan that week on Monday mornings early. And I just, as I'm planning my week, I go, okay, how did I do last week? It's that simple.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is that weekly planning
session like? It's evolved over the years, but I've done it forever. Literally the goal of that is just so I know, okay, like one, I can just assess how well did I live in line with my priorities, and how well did I live in line with the standards I have for each area of my life the previous week. So area of life being body, spiritual self, friendships, intimate relationship, family, business, like how well did I hold myself to those goals and standards? Mm-hmm. And then after I assess that and actually rate those 1 to 10, and then go, okay, like what needs to happen this week? What would need to happen this week to have an outstanding week or to make major progress towards my 1 or 2 major goals? I go, okay, cool. I'm going to go do that. Like, it's that simple. And in that process, I measure myself as far as the habits go, tying back to, yeah. Yeah. Gotcha.
Okay. Kind of got into this, but what role do health and fitness play in your life?
It's so important. I think it's more important just for, let me be more direct. I think people who don't have health and fitness as a priority in their life, I think it's really hard to get anything good done because you need physical energy. Mm-hmm. You just do. You need physical energy. And so like people at work are like, dude, how do you have so much energy? I'm just like, you know, I laugh because like for 3 years, I just had this like crazy autoimmune disease. And even during that time, I had more energy than people. And I think like what plays into it is obviously some really good habits. You got to eat well. You got to get your sleep. You got to work out. Cold showers help a lot. But then too, you got to like find a way to do something that you're really excited about, which isn't physical, but it isn't physical, but like it's just as important. But going back to the physical stuff, like, yeah, well, if you don't have your physical house, you don't even have a six pack or, you know, look like Will, but like, you gotta like show up and like make sure your body's moving and drink a lot of water and just do that. Otherwise you're not gonna have energy. If you don't have energy, you can't focus. Like, good luck doing what you want to do. Cause like life can be hard, man. Life has a lot of challenges. Like, you know, even doing the podcast like this, like there's challenges that happen along the way. You gotta navigate and shift. If you can't think properly or, you know, move properly or whatever, it's just hard to do anything that's worthwhile doing.
So what are your what's your diet like these days? So you said you had this, mm-hmm. these health issues that kind of forced you into a certain diet. What's it been like since then?
It's essentially like Whole 30. Okay. I essentially eat Whole 30. I mean, I'll have some gluten here or there or whatever, but like, you know, it aligns with my taste buds. I know like it's gonna be kind of wild. Like I decide like healthy food. I don't know what my body prefers it.
Yeah.
I just no more than that. I eat so I can live, not live so I can eat. Mm-hmm. Right? A lot of people live so they can eat. Right. So for me it's just fuel.
Yeah. Okay. And that's it.
That's it.
So it's not a difficult thing for you to manage.
No.
Okay. And then fitness, you said you work out every day. What does that look like?
I've been getting into yoga. Shout out Suka Yoga in South Lamar. Love you guys. And then I go to Squatch. Just started going there.
Okay.
Love that too. So like the yoga is just the yoga. The lifting is more just, I wouldn't say it's powerlifting, but it's more like CrossFit-esque. Actually, no, it's actually a lot of what you do. I change now. So I do a lot. So it's like 4 sets or 5 sets of like, and I do 7 reps. Mm-hmm. I do 4 or 5 exercises, 7 reps, and I'll take a 1 minute break between each set.
Okay.
Yeah. And I'll just do that. I don't try to overcomplicate. I just try to work out every single part of my body when I'm in there, and I go two or three times a week, and then that's it. And I go run some other days. Okay. Very, very simple. The key to being consistent is being very simple.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Simple. I think just doing it. And like you were saying with energy, like moving is the key to energy.
You just feel better, dude. Like if you're a dude, even if you're a girl, like, you know, like, I remember people laugh because, like, dude, you're just, like, you're generally in, like, a good mood and, like, you just, like, have all this energy and shit. It's, like, it's just because I move and I, like, I make a point to do it. So my body now is, like, it's wired to have that energy. Mm-hmm. I don't have to try. You know, it's just, it's that simple, man.
Yeah. It's simple. Yeah, whereas you can easily fall into a routine of, like, not. I had someone on recently who was talking about how a lot of people who go to the gym actually end up moving a lot less because they're like, I worked out, I'm good. And it's just lazy the rest of the time. But, like, just generally being active is also very important outside of just, like, your structured workouts.
I would agree with that. I think, again, I wonder if people move less because they're just not. They're just not that engaged with life, man. I think people just want to sit down and watch TV.
That could be too.
I think, you know, I just think, man, if you're really doing stuff, you're really engaged, like, you want to move. Your body wants to move. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, I don't know how it feels to inhabit someone else's body, so I can't, like, speak to that. I can speak for myself. When I don't want to move, I want to sit on the couch and just, like, not do anything, just, like, numb out to, like, scrolling through YouTube. So I'm generally, when I'm feeling just, like, disengaged or super tired and just, like, blah, you know.
Yeah, do you have do you have kind of, like, protocols when that does happen?
Sometimes I give myself, like, 15, 20 minutes. Cause sometimes I'm just like, okay, I just kind of need that. I can feel that's where the art comes in, where I've been managing. Like, I really believe in energy management over time management. Energy management is the ability to monitor your overall energy state on a daily basis and know what's needed when. So do I need a nap here? Do I need to give myself 10 minutes to scroll through stuff here? Mm-hmm. And, like, that's the management where everyone's focused on time management, which I believe in time management too, but, like, I'm really focused on how's my body flow throughout the day. I don't eat much before noon, because, like, I know my body's going to handle, like, I'm just going to be very alert. And then after, I want to eat at noon, like, very high protein, like, but just a little bit of carb. And, like, so, you know, that's all energy management. Cause I know then around 2, I'll probably take a little bit of a nap for 10 minutes, 20 minutes. I'll come back. I'll feel better. So yeah, that's so important. I don't even know what your question was, but that's how I answered that.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's just like how, when you go into a lull like that, where you're, like, disengaging.
Yeah, honestly, dude, if I feel like I'm in it for a little too, I kind of have like a sixth sense now. It's cause, like, it's just, I know it's just not who I am. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just like, all right, I'm going to go work out. I'm going to go to yoga. Right. I mean, I am human, dude. Like, I have moments where I'm like, oh, I just don't want to do this. And you just got to work through it. You just got to work through it. I think, candidly, like, if you're lucky, not lucky, if you've done the work to show up very consistently and work out on a consistent basis for a prolonged period, it's not as hard. It's when you're in it and you're so used to scrolling, sitting on a couch for so long, that's when it's harder. Mm-hmm. In the day, it's like, again, it all comes back to, who am I becoming by sitting on this couch for 20 more minutes? And, like, is this going to really lead to somewhere that I want to lead to? And then, you know, and I was really thinking about, who am I becoming by making this choice? Mm-hmm. So it all comes back to that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's, like, my anchor. If I'm, like, really, I'm like, dude, you're going to die. If you're going to spend your last days, is this how you want to do it? Yes or no? And it might not be everyone's tea, and that's fine, but, like, it's what's useful for me. That's
the wrong way to do it, though. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do like that framework. I think, I don't know. Whenever I hear that, I like it. And then it just, I don't know. I forget.
We all forget. It takes practice. Yeah. I forget.
It takes practice to, like, bring that up in the moments when you really need it.
Totally.
When have you failed in the past? And how
did you learn from it? Like, really? Like, failure with, I call, like, a capital F, like a big failure. When I fail in the past... Oh, goodness. I think, man, like, when I fail in the past and then what I learned from it, I think one of the things that I have really learned from is, and I was fortunate to have occur, is I'll go back to this health challenge I experienced. I mean, mm-hmm. beginning of 2020, I was, what, 24 years old, something like that. And like a normal 24-year-old dude, iron stomach, totally fine, whatever. And in a month, it went from that to, I've got, like, a hole in my fucking stomach. My immune system's fucked up. And I'm eating 6 fucking foods because I can't eat anything else. My energy's shit. And I think the biggest failure there was not realizing sooner that the anger and the stress I was in was something that I could control and I needed to change. And so that led me down this crazy path I never thought I'd go on, where I'd be going, I traveled across the world to go to these meditation retreats and try to heal myself. And just, and that was, it was a beautiful journey. It was fucking hard. It was absolutely, it was the gnarliest thing. I'm grateful for it. I had a decently gnarly childhood. What I went through those past 3 years was much harder, much more real. Mm-hmm. I think the biggest failure was not realizing sooner that the anger and the stress that I was under was a choice and that I could change at any time. And I think that my life would, I wouldn't be the person I am today without it, but my life would have been a lot easier if I would have realized that. But again, like retroactively, things are 2020. So I think that's the biggest failure, is not taking more ownership of my emotional state, and that I could really like dictate, and through my thoughts and through how I showed up every single day, through my emotions, like that I could really dictate the quality of my life. It took me a while to realize that. It's a mistake and I've learned from that. And so it honestly makes me even more excited for life going forward, because now I have that knowledge. So I had to transform my emotional state so I can transform my body. I mean, few people can say that they've had to do that. You know, it's like, it's insane. It's a very intense experience. So now that I have that knowledge and I have that experience, things are just easier. I mean, everything's fucking downhill. It's easy. You know, okay, this happened to my family. Can't be that bad. You know, things are just easier, dude.
Are you grateful for that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very.
Yeah. It's always the hardest things that cause the most growth.
Yeah, they also get like romanticized as these like amazing experiences. Like, it was fucking awful, dude. Yeah. I had depleted my bank account. I had 40 G's in fucking student loans. I didn't talk to like almost anyone about it to a certain extent, because like no one could help me anyway. I went doctor to doctor. I had no social life, because like what the fuck am I gonna do? Can't like, you know, and I don't drink now even, but like occasionally I have a straight martini, but like, you know, it's just like, yeah, like it's not pretty, dude.
No.
People romanticize failure and struggle and stuff. It's not pretty. It's not pretty. You know, it's not pretty, but like, it's part of life, dude. You know, we want to show that we're so fortunate. We live in this time. We have really good lives. I mean, we struggle, but like we struggle with like a small S, not a capital S, generally. And so then it's like, we don't really know what hard shit is. Some people do, but you know, so I just, it helped me develop a lot more empathy too. And just kindness, because you realize like, you know, that worker that is cleaning my you know apartment hallway that can hardly speak English, like I don't know what's going on in their world. So I give them a wave, I say hello. Probably the one of the only few people to do that. You know, like just small shit like that.
Yeah. Yeah, I do like what you're saying. Like when we hear stories about people's struggles, it does become that little piece where you're like, oh yeah, they went through that thing.
Yeah.
But you don't feel that.
But then what's nice is you build endurance, right? So now I'm like, oh, well, of course, on my like ninth podcast episode, the one I'm doing, I'm like, of course, I feel like I don't know what I'm doing. Of course, I feel like this is hard. Duh. Like, you know, you just keep going because it's just a big joke.
Yeah.
You know, all it is just an expected emotional response to something that's unknown. Because I've been there before in a much harder circumstance. So everything else is easy because you can build endurance. And so that's just like, yeah, it's an amazing thing. So people can, speaking of willpower, people can find ways to put themselves in really hard situations that aren't, you know, like life-threatening. Ice baths, working out really hard, being in an intense workout group or whatever, do it. You'll build endurance.
You think there's a difference between that and the voluntary versus the involuntary struggle?
Sure, dude. But I think like, I wouldn't advise anyone to ever develop some kind of autoimmune or issue or cancer or anything like that, you know? So there's a difference. The difference between the involuntary stuff is you can't escape.
Yeah.
And that is terrifying.
So is there something inherently that you cannot practice for that?
Sure, of course you can, but you can try to get close. It's just like, I don't know, I imagine it's like, just like, I mean, I've made at this point probably about 25,000 cold calls in my life. Mm-hmm. You can practice all you want in the mirror, but when you get live, way different feeling. And so like, but it still makes you better to a certain extent, right? And so like, I think that's too what's tough about willpower is like, if you had a really nice childhood and your parents were like fucking perfect and, you know, whatever, or you generally, or your childhood was good, generally it's not the, generally people's childhoods are like good enough where mm-hmm. like there wasn't that much issues, like their parents were okay, whatever. Right. It's hard to have willpower. It's just like, there's nothing there. You didn't really get kicked in the teeth as a kid. And there's a lot of benefit to just being sucker punched in the face by life when you're young. Cause then you have a chip on your shoulder and like, all right, let's go. And then you just develop that way. I say the people have the hardest time that I've met are the people that are just like, my childhood is pretty good. I mean, it's not everyone, just some people who are even great entrepreneurs or whatever that just like, you know, have great childhood. That's great. But like for a lot of people, it's just my childhood was good enough. And then they have a hard time in general because there's nothing to like, there's no backbone. They get knocked around a little bit.
You think that's necessary? The negative?
I think it's super helpful. I don't think it's necessary. You know, like I don't intend on my kids experiencing that, but like, will I have them like, you know, go and work a hourly job during high school? Heck yeah. I mean, I worked with Mexican immigrants for almost 4 years. And that helped me with my work ethic. I mm-hmm. woke up on Saturday mornings at 5 a.m. and went and worked a, you know, what was an 8-hour shift. So until 2, right? From 6 to 2. And I worked with Mexican immigrants and it made a huge difference. So I think you, there's little things you can do in life. I mean, David Goggins talks about this shit. You don't even listen to me, listen to him. But like, he talks about putting yourself in intentional situations to create. He calls it suffering. I'll just create I'll call it challenge. And like, it helps a lot. Mm-hmm. You can't be, yeah, you can you mimic like having some fucking disease? No, you can't do that. Like, cause you know, like it's not voluntary. You don't know if you're gonna make it out, right? It's a whole different story. But you can still train yourself.
Right, you can do parts of.
Yeah.
Yeah, what's something right now that you're struggling with?
I think it's learning how to balance. It's learning how to be more in flow with my learning how to be more in flow with life and not trying to use anger or drive as a way to move forward. But now it's just like, okay, example is I got these deals I'm working that are pretty big. And you know, those could be the money that someone can make if you're working a big deal is probably more than what someone makes in 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 months of work, depending on what line of work that they're in, maybe even more. Probably not more, but probably about 3 or 4, depending on what it is. Mm-hmm. And so like, you know, you got your stuff attached to it, whatever. And so I'm just working to be more in flow and just going, okay, like, let's just be here. Let's just be with it. Let's just like help these people to make a more informed decision, whether or not it's my company or not, just help them make a more informed decision. Like, you know, when I'm, when I'm working out, or even I was at the pool today with my like running group and I thought these like girls were cute and like they were very attractive and no one was talking to them. And I just like went up and I was like, hey, and I was just in flow with it. Right. I don't try to like, and I can see all the dudes, you know, and like, yeah, I had no business talking to them, but you know, it's just, I shouldn't say that one of them seemed like, but like regardless, like it's just like being more in flow versus trying to like force it. Just being like, all right, like there's an opportunity here. I'm just going to walk through the door.
Yeah.
I think that because then everything's easier because you're not like there's still some drive I think that is useful. And it's never if everyone wants like is it black or is it white? It's a spectrum, and you have to know like when am I going to tap in my drive right now or am I just going to kind of see this coming together? What is it? And it's that now I'm not working with because I've learned some of that just working through this fun period I had in my life. And so yeah, I would say it's that. I don't know what to call it. It's like working to be in flow with life. And then thinking bigger, right? Because now I'm like, okay, like I actually can like change the way that I think because I know how to. And if I change the way I think and show up, there's some weird metaphysical force that seems to bring these things into my life. And I can just like create shit. Like, let's think bigger because I have the motor to go do it. Like I have the endurance now. So I can work on bigger shit because I just have the endurance to keep going. So what now do I want to go work on? And then what am I not going to work on? Mm-hmm. Because I only have so much time. So what's a 10 out of 10 versus an 8 out of 10? And so those are the things I'm now working through is flow, prioritization. Those are the main things.
What's that been looking like, the thinking bigger?
Thinking bigger is leading out and like, okay, like, it could be small things of like, you know, why couldn't I make this much a year? It's nothing to do with the money. It's the person I'm going to become, because it forces me to expand. Mm-hmm. Where it's like, why couldn't I have this type of girlfriend? Why couldn't I talk to the girl? Like, you know, and then I thought to myself, like, why couldn't I go up to those girls and go talk to them? I mean, you know, on paper, totally on my league. Because of fuck, you know, like one of them totally wasn't interested. One of them wanted me to come to a yoga class. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's just kind of like, it's just, you don't know until you go up there and you start talking to them. But also in a more long-term view, it's like, what would keep me from being able to have an impact on the whole sales industry versus just a couple companies through the work I'm doing? Like, what would keep me from doing that? It's really nothing. It's just the limitation of
like, it's like a self-imposed thing.
Yeah. And again, there's going to be a bunch of shit. There's going to be a bunch of challenges. There's going to be a bunch of things that go wrong, but I'm also probably going to get lucky. I'm going to get some lucky breaks because I'm going to be there for long enough just doing the fucking thing. Right. And I'll probably get more lucky breaks than I will challenge, or when I will challenges. Maybe not. Maybe it'll be the other way. It doesn't really matter. I'm just going to keep showing up because I have the endurance. Yeah.
Yeah. As soon as you can, as soon as you have the belief that like, I think it's the negative belief that stops us. I think is if you have an absence of belief, you're good. It's like, as soon as you're like, oh, that's something I couldn't do, that's the one thing that you can't have. As long as you don't have that belief, as and you're willing to put in the work to get there, I don't think there's anything.
At this point in my life, my opinion is probably going to change as I get older and become less ignorant and or more wise, hopefully. Like, I think like people get too weirded out about beliefs. It's just like, if you have a goal you want to achieve and you like from a physiological standpoint, emotional standpoint, you just feel like you can't do it whenever you think about it. It's just like, all right, who do I need to become in order to be able to do that thing? And then what would a person who wouldn't be able to achieve that do? Cause now you got the inverse, cause your brain's really good at finding things to not do. All right. Well, they wouldn't sit on the couch all day and not go do something. They wouldn't, you know, spend, you know, I don't know, 2 G's going to some concert, they'd save it and go do X instead. So whatever that goal is, it's building a business or I don't know, maybe it's becoming better shape so that you can, you know, date someone that you find attractive and, you know, whatever it is, like, who do you need to become?
So you're,
because you can really transform how you think through thinking about that and then reiterating and then thinking about that every single day and feeling those emotions of that person who you want to become. Absolutely change your entire body and the way you think. Absolutely.
So it feels like you're pulling yourself out of your body. You're like looking at yourself.
Yeah, I'm just trying to keep it as simple as possible. Being yeah. Like,
this is a human being.
Being I've seen other who people. Who does this person need to become?
Who does this person need to become? What would make this person? It kind of takes your own like yes. charges and.
Yeah, I'd say like the biggest skill I've learned and been working on, I've gotten better at, is becoming. I almost want to call it like a evolution artist. Like I'm really good at evolving. Or I'm working to be really good at evolving. Of like, okay, if I have a character trait I don't like in myself, like how do I create a person that doesn't have that? Or if I have a skill set I need to build so I can go and make more money and really through providing more value, how do I build that skill set? And I just continually evolve. So the person I am sitting on this couch is not the person I am a month from now. And the person I am 6 months from now, the person I am, you know, a year later. Mm-hmm. Constantly evolve.
Do you have, we talked about habits earlier. What are your favorite day-to-day habits?
Waking up and just being grateful to be alive. Having coffee, you know, like, dude, it's like the simple stuff. It's just like going for a good workout. And just like talking to someone that I enjoy or care about, or just connecting with someone. You know, I don't have like I love my meditation. A lot of days I wake up and I don't want to meditate, to be honest with you. I'm just kind of like, fuck this. But I still do it. It feels good. My favorite one? Dude, my favorite one is the first time I just get to walk outside. I just get to feel the air. Because there's going to be a day where I don't get to do that. Whatever reason. Probably because I'm dead. And so, you know what I'm saying? Like, I just, me being able to walk. I mean, how many people on this planet just can't period walk, period, on their own? You know, like just like that, just being able to walk outside. I always go for a walk probably around like 9:30. I wake up around 4:30, start working around 6, 6:10, 6:20. I go for a walk around 9:30. It's just like that. It's just being in the sun. So many people can't. Some people can't even walk. You know, you think about that for a second, like feel that, like who can't walk, dude? Or like they're wrongly like in prison. They're in a fucking prison. Like you really think about it, people are like that. Or they just can't go walk or they want to. It's like pause and like, you know, think about that for a second. You know, like that's very real for people. Like that's insane. That's insane. Can you imagine being trapped like that? And so that is just being able to go on a walk and just enjoy outside. I mean, even runs as deep, dude. Sometimes when I'm walking outside from the sun, I'm like, you know, there's going to be a day where, you know, the earth evolves to the point where, you know, it starts to crumble or whatever. And like, we're not going to have a day like this again. You know, you just got to like really think about like, you have to just, I don't know. That's probably my absolute favorite thing, you know, which is enjoying that because mm-hmm. I realize it's not always going to be like this.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot that we take for granted that, like you said, I think understanding that it is not a given. Some people don't have this.
Yeah.
You at some point will not have this. Can make it, possible to enjoy.
And I think all the other stuff I do from the habits perspective, the meditation, the working out, the eating well, enables me to feel that way. Because like, I can go on a walk and just go and like, I'm healthy. I feel good. I'm not in pain. You know, like I can go out and buy whatever the fuck I want. Like if I want to take the day off, I can take the fucking month off. I don't give a shit. You know what I'm saying? Like I can do that. You know, and not everyone has that freedom. Very, very few people do. And I'm very, very grateful. So I think that is what like the habits and the discipline, the willpower enables that. And because I'm also doing something that's challenging. I know I'm facing fears every single day when I'm, you know, cause I could, you know, could make a mistake and blow up the deal. I could say the wrong thing to the girl that I really like down, you know, a couple fucking units, you know, whatever it is. But so it's like, I'm just grateful that I'm like at my edge. Like people can't appreciate stuff like that if they're not living in line with their values and they're not challenging themselves because there's no ability to feel fulfillment like that.
Why do you think that is?
Because because you're in constant angst. You know you're not living a life that you're capable of. And everyone's got a soul. I really believe that. I think like there's a lot of wisdom in people's souls. And I think at least my experience has been that it's more about pulling the wisdom out and trying to like uncover, like unmuck whatever's been like, and just trying to like be more just like what your soul's actually like and just living through that and living through your heart. And I think people aren't doing that. So if you're not doing that, it's hard to enjoy anything because you're constantly in your head. You're constantly insecure. You're constantly thinking about people thinking about you. Dude, I don't give a fuck. You know, like, yeah, of course, the time, but like, I don't care. You know, like, and I just think like when you don't challenge yourself like that, like you don't feel good. You don't feel good when you aren't living in line with your life, when you're not challenging yourself, being disciplined every day and like, or trying your best to be disciplined every day and you're not really challenging. I mean, dude, people aren't making progress in areas that matter most. That's like a fast track to being dissatisfied and eventually depressed if you lose hope. Or, you know what I'm saying? Like that's just it's basic psychology, period. Yeah.
Yeah. What does your dream life look like? And what, if anything,
the answer came up when you asked that question from like just within. It said the life I'm living now. Because like, dude, I'm challenging myself. Right? I'm doing things I'm excited about. I'm doing things that I feel so unqualified to go do. And you know, I've got great friends. One I'm sitting with right now. We haven't talked in a bit, but like I know when I see you, like I know we're gonna have a great conversation. I know, like, you know, if you need anything, you know, it's like, and so I just like I'm challenging myself in all areas. And I'm not making excuses like I used to for why I feel like it's. I take full ownership. And I take full ownership of, you know, getting real, real with you. Like I take full ownership of anything that happened to me as a child. And even though a lot of it mostly wasn't quote unquote my fault, I take full ownership for my emotional reaction. You know, when you get to that place where you take full ownership for that, you can live a really good life, you know? And like, I didn't grow up in a house that was economically, but I grew up in a nice neighborhood, you know, there's a whole, you know, story I'll save you there. But like, you know, like I'm doing everything I wanted to go do. I'm like on the path, right? Am I like where exactly I want to like be? In a way, yeah, because the whole point of those goals that I have is to go and live and do what I'm doing now, and just to go challenge myself and to go be a better person, feel around me, and hopefully provide value to people, hopefully love people, right? That's the whole fucking point. People don't want the $100 million in a bank account. They want how they're going to feel afterward, you know? So yeah, but like, what does it look like eventually? Like from like a more visual standpoint? I mean, really, dude, it's like talking about shit like this. It's coaching people on sales, more mental performance than anything else. It's obviously having my own business. It's having a great family. You know, that's what it all looks like. But I mean, I'm taking the actions now, so it feels like I'm there now because I'm doing the exact same shit I'd had to be doing, generally, right? So yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right, thank you, John. Where can people find out more about you?
Hit me up on LinkedIn. That's the main one. I don't have an Insta anymore. I'm on TikTok, but not really, because I was doing cold call videos for fun. Hit me up on LinkedIn. I have obviously the Beyond Pipeline podcast. So that is a place where we talk about how top performers win the inner game of sales. So I bring on a lot of thought leaders in the sales space. Also just some sales reps. And we talk about what they do to manage their inner game. Also is how they sell more, because I find the psychology of selling really interesting. And yeah, LinkedIn's the main place. And so it's the podcast on Spotify, App Podcasts, YouTube. So hit us up, and I hope it's helpful. And just, that's all I got.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm going to take a lot from this.
So. Awesome, dude.
Appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. Cool, dude.
Bye, everybody.